Hello everyone, thank you for attending my talk. I'm Sili. I'm happy to share my topic today. My topic is Cherry Fuzzer, coverage guided binary fuzzing with Breakpoint. First of all, please allow me to introduce myself. I am security researcher at Huawei Root Lab. I focus on software vulnerability research. Below are my Twitter and GitHub links. The tool will be open sourced on GitHub. If you are interested, you can follow me. Next, I will show my topic. Let's start our topic. This is the outline of today's presentation. Firstly, I will introduce some background of Cherry Fuzzer. Next, I will explain the implementation of the tool. Then I will take WPS Office as an example to explain how to fuzz software with Cherry Fuzzer and the fuzzing result. Finally, I will summarize the speech and introduce some future plans. Now, I will introduce some background knowledge of Cherry Fuzzer, including the concept of fuzzing as well as the comparison of developing Cherry Fuzzer. First of all, let's take a look at what is fuzzing. The simplest fuzz is shown in the figure. The code in the figure is to generate random binary data. Then, if we feed the output data to target process, this is fuzzing. Next, I will briefly introduce coverage-guided fuzzing. The general workflow of coverage-guided fuzzer is shown in the figure. It usually maintains a queue of seed test cases and performs a fuzzing loop. First, the fuzzer will select a test case and mutate it to generate a new test case. Then, fuzzer will feed the new test case to target process. Unlike black box fuzzing, coverage-guided fuzzer will monitor the program execution to check its code coverage. If the test case finds new code coverage, the fuzzer will put the test case into the queue. Through this feedback mechanism, fuzzer can automatically generate efficient test cases so that fuzzer can fuzz the deep logic of the program. Next, let me introduce two main events that inspired me to develop Cherry Fuzzer. I show on the left side of the slide. In April 2020, Google Project Zero published a research about fuzzing in major I/O on macOS system. In order to perform coverage-guided fuzzing in macOS, the OS support a novel binary instrumentation method to home fuzz. It first obtains the start offset of each basic block in the program through IDA Python. Then it will patch the module in memory, which just replaces the first byte of every basic block with 0xCC. 0xCC is the breakpoint instruction on Intel. Then it will register a SIG traps handler to handle the breakpoint events, and finally get the basic block that has been executed. This article reminds me of a research in 2018, which is the right side of the slide. Its main idea is to obtain coverage by patching the first instruction of each basic block in file. The difference with Google Project's method is that it directly patches executable file instead of patching memory. After patching the file, it runs the target process by a custom debugger and handles the breakpoint event in it. Combining my previous fuzzing experience and this tool security research, I realized that first, the existing excellent fuzzing tools such as AFL home fuzz are not perfect, and they are still unsupported or incompletely supported scenarios such as large closed source programs and some special operating system. Second, using relatively inefficient instrument method for fuzzing can also obtain better results than complete black box fuzzing, such as instruments with breakpoints. I also searched through Google and found that fuzzing tools for large closed source Linux software are rare. Commonly used Linux fuzzing tools are PitchFuzzer and AFL. They both have some shortcomings. First, PitchFuzzer don't support coverage information. Second, AFL QEMU mode is only suitable for relatively small programs, such as an image pass library. So I decided to develop a fuzzer based on the breakpoint mechanism to support some scenarios that are not covered by existing tools, such as large closed source file passing software and provide coverage support. Next, I will introduce the implementation of child father, including the software architecture and the implementation of each module. First, let's take a look at the overall architecture of child father. Child father can be divided into four components, namely binary patch module, father schedule module, seed mutation module, and the trace module. The workflow of the tool is as follows. First, the user find the modules that need being instrumented, then use binary patch to pair the target module. It will replace the first instruction of each basic block with a breakpoint instruction. In this step, we directly pair the executable file in file system. Then user start the father and provide some initial test case for fuzzing. The father will randomly select a test case from the seed queue and hand it to the seed mutation module. The seed mutation module will mutate the test case to generate a new test case. Then father will feed the new test case to target program. Then the trace module starts the target process in debug mode. It will handle the breakpoint events of target process. Finally, the trace module will give the obtained coverage information to the father. The father schedule module will use this coverage information to determine whether the test case needs to be added to the queue, and at the same time, father will score the succeed in the queue. The above is the approximate workflow of child father. Next, I will introduce each module in detail. First, I will introduce the implementation of the binary patch module. This page describes the working mechanism of the binary patch module. The input of binary patch is the executable file that needs to be instrumented, such as a library. The output is the patched file and the basic block info file. The basic block info file stores each basic block information of binary file, including the virtual offset, the file offset, and the first instruction of each basic block. The workflow of this module is shown in the figure. First, the user provides some modules that need to be instrumented, such as label A.E.SO, label B.SO, label X.SO. Then the binary patch will start multiple IDA instances to analyze these shared libraries. After the analysis is completed, it will use the IDA Python script to extract the information of each basic block and save it as a basic block info file. Finally, the binary patch will patch this shared library according to the basic block info file. It will replace the first instruction of basic block with breakpoint instruction. Next, I will introduce some examples. And shown in the figure is an example of basic block info file. The format of the file is as follows. The first 4 bytes indicate the size of the file in the memory. Next is the file name of the executable file corresponding to the basic block info file. The file name is followed by the bbinfo structure list. The bbinfo structure list representing the information of each basic block. There are 3 members in bbinfo structure. The meaning of each member is as follows. First, RVA represents the module offset of the basic block in the process memory. FOFF represents the offset of the basic block in the file. Inst size and inst indicate the bytecode for the first instruction of the basic block. This picture shows the difference between an ELF executable file before and after being patched. The left side of the picture is the original file. The right side is the patched file. We can see that some instruction in the original file has been replaced with 0xCC, which is actually the bytecode of the breakpoint instruction. Here are 2 screenshots of IDA. The left is the original binary, the right is the binary after patch. You can see that some instructions have been replaced with int 3 instruction. Next, let's take a look at the implementation of the seed mutation module. As shown in the figure, the seed mutation is to randomly replace some data in the test case. Currently, there are 2 seed mutation modules in child father. Red MSAR and mutator and tiny mutator. And msa mutator encapsulator and msa is an open source seed mutation tools. Tiny mutator is a relatively simple seed mutation tools, including some basic mutation strategies such as beta flipping and bound value replacement. Unlike a random msa mutator, tiny mutator supports configure the ratio of seed mutation so that the mutator will only mutate a small part of the test case. The comparison of these two mutators will be introduced later. Let's continue. On this page, I will introduce the implementation of the father module. The father module will first load the initial test case to seed queue and do corpus destination on it. Then it will traverse the seed queue, mutate the test case, and use the trace module to start the target process. Finally, it will get the coverage and execution status of the process. If new coverage is found, the new test case will be added to the seed queue. If crash is found, the crash context is saved, such as register and stack trace. There are also two simple scheduling strategies in the father module. The score of test cases that found new coverage will increase. The score of test cases that trigger those vulnerabilities will decrease. The purpose of this is one to further explore new coverage as much as possible and to find fewer those vulnerabilities because those bugs will waste too much time. The workflow of corpus destination is as follows. First, the further let the program process each test case in the seed queue. Then only save the test case which can generate unique coverage to seed queue. In this way, we can reduce the number of test cases in the seed queue. The figure below is an example. There are 5 test cases in the initial seed queue. The basic block coverage by these 5 test cases are A, B, C, D, E, F. The test case 1, 2 and 5 in the queue can also cover A, B, C, D, E, F. Therefore, the final test case saved in the seed queue after destination is test case 1, 2, 5. Next, I will introduce the implementation of the trace module. I will first introduce the principle of the trace module. Firstly, we use the binary patch to replace the first instruction of each basic block in the executable file with breakpoint instruction. Then, we use the trace module to start the program. The trace module will process the breakpoint event and record the PC register. When the breakpoint is triggered, then it will replace the breakpoint instruction with the original instruction and then let the program continue. In this way, we can get all basic blocks that have been executed. Therefore, the trace module in ChariotFather is actually a simple debugger. Next, I will introduce the first trace module. Its name is Python ptrace-tracer. According to the previous introduction, we know that the trace module is actually a simple debugger. Since the other modules of ChariotFather are developed with Python, I also wanted to implement a debugger through Python. After searching, I found the Python ptrace library. Through this library, we can use the ptrace in Python. In addition, there is also a debugger demo in the code of Python ptrace library. So we can quickly implement the trace module based on the debugger demo. The workflow of the trace module is as follows. First, we use create and attach process to start the target process. Then use continue function to let the process continue. And use wait signals function to wait for the process trigger seek trap signals. When the process executed a breakpoint, it will trigger the seek trap signal. It means that a new basic block is executed. Then, tracer saves the current PC register and removes the breakpoint instruction. Then, it lets the process continue to execute. After finishing the first version of ChariotFather, I hope to find some real programs to test it. After some searching, I found that WPS Office released a Linux version software in 2019. WPS is an office software in China that supports Vue and edit Word, Excel, PowerPoint, and other file formats. It supports various operating systems, including Windows, Linux, macOS, and so on. Finally, I decided to use WPS as my first fuzzing target. In the previous introduction, we know that the child fuzzer will trace program by patching executable file with breakpoint. So we need to find the module need to be instrumented before fuzzing, which is the module responsible for parsing the input file. Next, I will introduce how to quickly find the file parsing modules in target software. We know that the general workflow of the file parsing program is as follows. First, the program will open the file. Then it will read data from the file and pass it. Finally, it will close the file. In this process, program will call some library functions. Therefore, we can quickly find the file parsing modules by hooking library functions such as file operations, and then we can check the code stacks of target library functions. On the Windows platform, we can use process monitor to trace the file operations of the target process and obtain the corresponding code stack. As shown in the figure is an execution log captured by the process monitor when WPS is parsing a doc file. When we check the code stack of the read file functions, we can find that there are two DLL belong to the WPS, which are kso.dll and wpsmain.dll. Read file is a Windows API for reading file data. We can infer from the log that these two libraries should be responsible for parsing file data. In this way, we can find the modules that need to be instrumented. On the Windows platform, we can quickly locate the file parsing module with the help of process monitor. However, there is no such easy-to-use monitor tools for Linux platform. Similar tools under the Linux platform are Strace and Ltrace. These tools are used to monitor system calls or library function calls, but they cannot obtain the call stack or target function, so it is not very useful for us. After some research, the best tool to get the call stack under the Linux platform is GDB, so I decided to implement a simple version of process monitor based on the GDB plugin. Its implementation is to set some breakpoints for commonly used file operation functions. Then it will check the file name after program hit the breakpoint. If the file operation is for the target file, the call stack is recorded. Let's take a brief look at the implementation of Linux version file monitor. This picture on the left is the code for hooking fopen function. Breakpoints can be set through the gdb.breakpoint class. In the stop function of breakpoint class, user can customize the breakpoint processing behavior. If the file to be opened is determined to be a DOC file, the call stack will be printed, and some information will be recorded. Then it will replace a breakpoint on the return address of the call to fopen. The purpose is to obtain the return value of fopen, which is used to filter fread, fwrite, and other function calls later. The picture on the right is the call stack of the read and fwrite functions when WPS is parsing the doc file. In the call stack, we found that the Linux version of kso.dll and wpsmain.dll, namely libwpsmain.so and libkso.so. In addition, I also found libwpsio.so. In this way, we can locate the file parsing module of WPS for Linux. This page shows the modules that need to be patched when WPS parses doc file on the Windows and Linux platform. On the left is Linux, on the right is Windows. When I started fuzzing, I found that Python ptrace tracer can't trace the WPS process. After WPS was executed for a period of time, it will crash. I guess that Python ptrace may have some bug in processing multi-thread programs. After some research, I found that GDB is an excellent debugger for Linux platform, so I decided to develop the trace module based on GDB. The reasons are as follows. First, GDB has fewer bugs and can get completely code stack of the process and supports various architectures. Second, we can use Python to develop GDB plugins. Third, GDB is open source. We can customize it as needed. Next, I will introduce the implementation of GDB Python plugin tracer. First, I will introduce some GDB Python API used by this tracer. ReadRegister function is used to read register value. Read and write memory function is used to read and write process memory. Pass and eval function is used to execute GDB translation and get the results of translation. Execute function is used to execute GDB command and get the results of command execution. GDB.events.stop.connect function is used to register a GDB stop event callback function. When target process triggers a signal, it will enter the callback functions for processing. Next, I will introduce the implementation of the tracer. When the process executes the breakpoint instruction, the seek trap signal will be triggered. If the breakpoint is not set by GDB, the callback function registered through gdb.events.stop.connect will be triggered. Due to the limitation of the GDB Python plugin, when GDB enters the stop callback function, the GDB process will enter its command loop, and the GDB needs waiting for user input. Therefore, it is necessary to send the continue command to the stdin of GDB after it stops. Only in this way, the debugged process can continue execution after it executed a breakpoint instruction. Let's take a look at the communication between fuzz and the tracer. GDB Python plugin tracer consists of two parts. Charfuzz.py is a Python plugin for GDB. It runs in the GDB process. GDB Python plugin tracer.py is responsible for interacting with GDB, including start one test and get the results of the test. It runs in fuzz process. First, the fuzz generates test case through the seed imitation module. Then it could feed the test case to the target program. Then the fuzz starts the GDB with trap.py. After trap.py is loaded, it will load the basic block info file and then start the process. When the process triggers a breakpoint, GDB would handle the seek trap signal. It will enter the callback function registered in trap.py. The function will record the PC value at this time and then restore the original instruction at that position. Due to the limitation of the GDB plugin, the process will be suspended and GDB will wait for user input. Then further process sending continue command to the stdin of GDB, it would let target process continue execute. Next, let's take a look at the core code of the tracer. First, take a look at the code of the GDB plugin part, which is trap.py. In the code, it first registers the stop callback function through gdb.events.stop.connect API. In the callback function, if it is a breakpoint event, function first search basic block info file according to the PC and get the original instruction at that location. Then it removes the breakpoint instruction and record the address of the basic block. Finally, it will let the process re-execute this instruction by setting the PC register. Next, I will introduce the implementation of GDB Python plugin tracer. It first starts the GDB process through subprocess and load trap.py. Then it will monitor the stdout of the GDB. If GDB prints received the signal seek trap, it means that the process has executed a breakpoint and trap.py has already handled the seek trap signal. At this time, it will send a continue command to stdin of GDB to let the process continue to execute. And after the process is started, the script will set a timer and kill the process when the timer expires. The purpose of the timer is to detect those vulnerabilities. Now we have a trace module that can trace WPS. We can start fuzzing with a GDB Python plugin tracer, but there are two problems that affect the fuzzing speed. The first problem is that WPS will not exit the process after passing the file, but will stay on the GUI interface and waiting for the user to operate. So the fuzzer needs to manually kill the process. Therefore, the problem is when to kill the process. The commonly used method is to set a timeout. When the timeout occurs, the fuzzer will kill the process. This approach has two disadvantages as follows. The first disadvantage is that due to the setting of timeout, the execution time for each test case is fixed. When process pass simple test case, which actually passing time is less than timeout, it will waste time. When process passing complex test case, which actually passing time is greater than timeout, it will result in an incomplete file passing. The second disadvantage is that it cannot detect those vulnerabilities. The following describes ChairFuzzer's solution to this problem. Generally, the application will execute the same code every time when it enters the GUI loop. So if we kill the application when it enters one of the basic blocks of the GUI loop, we can avoid wasting time and ensure that the input file has been completely passed. The workflow is as follows. First, we use the trace module to trace the program execution and print the executed basic blocks. Then we can find the last basic blocks executed by the process after it enters the GUI loop. We named it endBBL. In the following fuzzing, when the process reaches endBBL, it means that the process have entered the GUI loop and the process can be killed at this time. In addition, during the fuzzing, the fuzzer will also record the execution time of each test case, which is used to calculate the average execution time. The average execution time is used to calculate the timeout of those vulnerabilities. When the execution time is greater than timeout, it is considered that those vulnerabilities have been found. This is a video of obtaining endBBL with the trace module. It can be seen that the process will continue to execute the new basic blocks at the beginning. But when it enters the GUI loop, there are no new basic blocks being triggered. So when WPS GUI has finished the rendering, the error marked red in the figure is a basic block of GUI loop. We can use it as endBBL. Next, I will introduce the second problem that greatly affects the speed of fuzzing. For large software, because the number of breakpoints is very large, it will take a lot of time for each execution. This will cause our fuzzing speed to be very slow. The following tables show the number of breakpoints that the program needs to patch. ChairFuzzer implement an accelerated mode to handle this problem. First of all, we know that in ChairFuzzer, the trace module will save and send the basic block information of each test case to the fuzzer. In the accelerated mode, the fuzzer first obtains the executed basic blocks from the trace module, then remove the breakpoints of these basic blocks in the file system. In this way, the breakpoint instruction of each basic block will only be triggered once during the entire fuzzing process, or it will never be triggered. The result is that the average execution time of the program in fuzzing is similar to the program without instrumentation. As shown in the figure, the blue rectangle in the figure represents a module being instrumented. The small yellow rectangle represents the breakpoint instruction in the module. The small white rectangle represents the original instruction in the module. The first blue box indicates that when module is instrumented, there will be a lot of breakpoints instructions in it. The second blue box indicates that some breakpoints in the module are removed after the first execution. The third blue box indicates that more breakpoints are removed after the second execution. With the running of fuzzing, there will be few and few breakpoints in the module, and the number of the breakpoints triggered by each execution will gradually decrease. So the traced process will execute at a speed closer to the original execution. Of course, there is a problem with this approach. Due to the optimization method, we can only obtain basic block coverage information because only test cases that triggered new basic block can be saved during the fuzzing process, and there is no edge coverage information. But despite this, it is much better than black box fuzzing, which is without coverage guiding. After solving this problem, we can finally start fuzzing WPS. Let's take a look at a video of fuzzing WPS. During the fuzzing process, WPS will restart multiple times. During the test, GDB Python plugin tracer will process the breakpoint event triggered by the process and send the result to the fuzzer when process exit. Currently, we can fuzz WPS. I first fuzzed with a random sum tater, but no crash was found after 3 days of fuzzing. After that, I tried to fuzz it with a tiny mutator, and I found more than 10 crash after fuzzing in 1 day. I guess the reason may be as follows. Random sum mutator doesn't consider the ratio of data mutation, which directly mutates the content of the entire file. This may seriously destroy the file structure, cause the test case to be discarded very early, so that deep vulnerabilities cannot be found. Due to the mutation ratio, tiny mutator will only mutate a small part of the test case, so that most of the structure is valid. Then we can find the deep logic of the software and find more vulnerabilities. Currently, ChildFuzzer can fuzz Linux software. In order to further enhance the fuzzing speed of the Linux platform and make it easy for user debugging, I developed ChildFuzzer GDB tracer by modifying the GDB source code. Next, I will introduce the implementation of this. First of all, I will introduce why I want to modify the GDB source code to develop ChildFuzzer GDB tracer. Although GDB Python plugin tracer can meet the fuzzing requirements, there are still some shortcomings, such as, first, it is inconvenient to debug. We need to use a Python script to send a continue command to the std of GDB. Second, we need to restart GDB for each test. The Python runtime, the communication of the trace module and fuzzer will cause additional performance overhead. And the ChildFuzzer GDB tracer have following advantages. First of all, its speed will increase, and we can compile static link GDB to reduce the requirements of environment, and it is easy to debug. In order to modify GDB, we first need to understand the code of GDB. On the Linux platform, GDB uses the ptrace to debug a program. In addition, it will pass the ELF file used in the debugged process so that a relatively complete code stack can be obtained. When GDB starts the debugged program, it will call start event loop function to start the event loop and waiting for events from the target process, such as hitting a breakpoint, creating a child process, and so on. The following figure shows the code stack of GDB when it handles breakpoint events. Next, I will introduce how GDB processes the breakpoint events. First, GDB starts the event loop through the start event loop function. When the process reaches the breakpoint instruction, The kernel will send the seek trap signal to the target process. And this time, GDB will call GDB do one event to process the event. And finally, call handle inferior event to handle the event of the target process. If it is a signal event, it will enter handle signal stop. Handle signal stop function is used to handle the situation where the debugged process stops due to receiving a signal. The screenshot is the code used to handle the seek traps event and the handle signal stop function. We can also use similar code to implement our tracer. Next, I will introduce the modification for GDB. We mainly modify the handle signal stop function to let GDB automatically handle the breakpoint events of process. The logic of processing seek trap signal after modification is as follows. First, it gets the value of the PC register and then finds the module that where the PC is located. Then according to PC and the basic block info file, it can get the original instruction of the position. Finally, replace the breakpoint instruction with the original instruction and let the process continue to execute. Next, I will introduce some useful GDB functions. We can use addCom function to add custom GDB commands and use execute command to string function to execute GDB command. The screenshot is the code that verifies the GDB automatically process the seek trap signal. The workflow is as follows. First, it finds the corresponding module according to the PC and calculate the module offset. Then it removes the breakpoint instruction at this position according to the offset and the basic block info file. Finally, it uses keep going function to let the process continue to run and let GDB don't stop. Let's take a look at the interaction diagram between the tracer and the fuzzer. The main difference is that all seek trap events are processed in GDB and GDB will only be started once during the entire fuzzing process. The subsequent task control and tracer information interaction are all done through sockets. First, the fuzzer generates a new test case. Then fuzzer informs trap fuzzer GDB to start one fast task through the socket and the tracer will start the target process. If a breakpoint event is triggered during the execution of target process, trap fuzzer GDB will handle it. Trap fuzzer GDB will return the execution information to fuzzer. Next, I will introduce the implementation of trap fuzzer on the Windows platform. In order to support Windows platform, we only need to implement a Windows debugger. The best solution for developing Windows debugger with Python is WinAppDBG. The advantages of using WinAppDBG to develop a debugger is that it is developed with Python. And there are many sample codes. We can quickly develop the tracer based on these sample codes. The disadvantage is that, first, because it is developed with Python, the execution speed is relatively slow. Second, WinAppDBG can't obtain the complete code stack. The working mechanism of WinAppDBG tracer is no different with the previous tracer, which is just dealing with breakpoint events. As mentioned earlier, WinAppDBG has some shortcomings. By searching in Google, I found that the DBG Engine API can be used to develop Windows debugger. The DBG Engine API is a series APIs for developing debuggers provided by Microsoft. User only need to register the corresponding callback function to implement a debugger. The advantages of developing a debugger based on the Debug Engine API are as follows. First, because it is developed by C, the execution speed is relatively fast. Second, it can get the completely code stack of the program. Next, let's briefly introduce the code how DBG Engine Tracer handles breakpoints. First, in DBG Engine, you can use the write virtual and read virtual function to read and write memory of the process. And the get stack trace function is used to get the code stack of the process. The code for handle breakpoints is shown in the screenshot. The logic of the code is similar, so I won't repeat it here. Let's take a look at the demo of Fuzzy Event Sprint form. Next, I will introduce the crash duplication scheme in the child father. First, we get the code stack of the process when it crashes. Then, we take out the lower 12 bytes of each layer of the code stack for splicing. The results of splicing is used as the hash of the crash. When a new crash occurs, it will judge according to the hash whether the crash has been recorded before. The figure below is an example of calculating hash of the crash. When the GUI program is executed, if there is an error, it usually pops up a dialog box. Fuzzy need to automatically handle this dialog box. The common way to solve this problem is to use Python AutoEat library to automatically process the dialog box. As shown in the figure, we can use AutoEat to search for target dialog box and then call AutoEat.controlClick to automatically click the button. Or we can use some existing tools such as Huarong, which is a Chinese antivirus software. It carries a tool for processing the dialog box. The advantage of using Huarong is that you can directly use the GUI to select the dialog box needed to be closed. Then as long as the dialog box appears in the future, it will automatically handle it for us. The following figure shows several dialog box rules, which I used to fuzzing Microsoft Office. Here is another useful feature of child father. Child father will listen a management port when it started. User can connect to the management port through NC at any time to check the status of the fuzzing process, such as the number of paths found, crash information, and execution speed. Next, I will introduce the preparation for starting fuzzing and the results of fuzzing. Before we start fuzzing, we need to prepare some environments. We know that fuzzing has three important factors, which is execution speed, sample quantity, mutation algorithm. There are several command method for obtaining samples. The details are as follows. I usually use the second and first methods. In order to further increase the speed, we can use RAM disk, which can speed up the I/O operation of the program. For file fuzzing, it can improve the execution speed, but you must pay attention to regular backup files because the files in the RAM disk will no longer exist when the machine is restarted. We can use the mount command to create the RAM disk on Linux, and we can use the IM disk toolkit on Windows. My father equipment is my laptop. Its configuration is as follows. I run two virtual machines on it. The final fuzzing results are shown in the table. You can see that child fuzzing have found many vulnerabilities in various software. The following is a simple comparison between child fuzzing and other fuzzer. After comparison, we know that the advantages of child fuzzing is that it is relatively simple to use and can support coverage. Here I will summarize my speech. First, seed is important and mutation ratio is also important. Second, the GDB and the debug engine API is very nice. Third, fuzzing with brick coverage is much better than none. There are some future plans. First, support more architecture such as ARM MIPS. Second, optimize the distributed fuzzing scheduling. Third, automatically detect data mutation ratio and mutation range. First, more precise crash deprecation mechanism, and so on. Thank you, everyone. The above is all my speech.